That was the dream, improvising right there. But prior to that, I just want to give a round of applause for our guest DJ today. Keep going, man. Keep it going, man. First person of hip hop to win a Grammy Award. Keep it going, ladies and gentlemen. Keep it going. He performed with Herbie Hancock and the Rocket Band for the 100th anniversary of the Los Angeles Philharmonic Orchestra. Keep the applause going, ladies and gentlemen. Founder of Team Hip Hop. Keep the applause going. Inducted into the Guitar Center Rock Walk of Fame in 2014. Keep it going, man. The term turntablism came from Herbie Hancock in reference to him. Keep it going, man. It was clubs like his, the Roxy, that helped set the tone to how we party in hip-hop. Keep it going, man. And he's here with us today and just did an amazing set and took us up the history of hip-hop, how it all began with the dancers and the DJs, the one and only Grand Mixer DXT.
Salute.
Amazing.
What an amazing mix, man.
Thank you. I did it on the fly, bro.
Yeah, I just saw that. You just that's what you do.
Yeah, Show off.
It's about selecting, feeling the energy, and know what to play next. Every record I play, I'm in the band.
So you worked with everybody you
played? No, I'm in the band.
But you're in your head.
Psychologically, I'm in.
You was right there with Jimmy Cassidy.
Yeah, I was right there with Jimmy, and I was like, you know what? James should join the band now and play his song.
And then you mix it in.
Yeah. You know.
That's an interesting mentality. When did you first start, like, your first public gig as a DJ? What year was that?
It was, I grew up in a family that partied a lot.
Okay.
And so we used to go to house parties in Mount Vernon. That's where I got most of my education in music. I was around, my mother's a singer, and so I was around musicians and stuff like that. So I was actually a bartender once. I was about 9 years old. I know that's kind of crazy.
Were you a bartender at 9 years
old? It was a house party.
Hold up, man. Come on, man.
It was a house party.
What were you serving? Kool-Aid?
No. I was actually serving drinks.
Oh, okay.
You know, it was a house party, so I met family members.
Were you mixing the drinks, or you was just handling
them? I was spilling the shit all over the place.
Okay, fine, okay.
But yeah, I did do that.
Okay.
But at those parties, my uncle Rex and my aunt Audrey, who Rex Garvin had hit songs. He was on American Bandstand and all that stuff.
Yeah.
Every one of us had to, at some point of the night, we all had to perform something. So you had to sit down and think about what you're going to do, because showtime was for the kids. And we all had to get out there and perform something. My cousin Rex, he was Barry White, so he'd get the pomp, the fur, and have two little girls dragging on his legs and stuff.
it was like insane. Like the Apollo at your house.
Yeah, right? It was insane, So, but my first actual party was a birthday party as a solo, because I really started DJing at mid to late 75. And I did my first party at a friend of mine, Jill's birthday party. And I had two stereo sets. Neither one of them were mine. And I turned one stereo set up and the other one down. But all through my life, like in PS 111 elementary school.
You have to explain why you turned one stereo set up and the other one down.
Well, because there's two stereo sets and there was no mixer. So you turn one stereo down and turn the other stereo up.
When you change records.
When you change records. And they had the big hook on the top where the record stack and they drop. So you had to be very quick about it. Because remember, that sometimes they'd automatically, the needle would automatically jump up. And that happened to me several times. I almost got fired for that. But
And at that time, in a broader context, what was going on in hip hop in 75? That you can remember. Well, who were...
At that time, it was really about the dancers.
Okay.
There was no MCing except for, you know, people toasting on the mic like Coke LaRock. Coke LaRock was from the Herculoids, and he was...
This is what we're going to do. Like, I know this stuff, but a lot of the folks we're talking to don't know who the Herculoids are. So you got to...
Well, the Herculoids was... And that was actually the name of their sound system. They really never called themselves the Herculoids. The people did, because of how they named their sound system. So certain things in hip-hop came indirectly, like the term hip-hop itself. that was a derogative term used towards the dancers.
Oh.
Mm-hmm.
And it, like, we'd go to people's parties, because most of us was like street kids, dirty. We were the sneaker kids. We couldn't get into the places where they wore shoes. Mm-hmm. And when we'd show up there, and I know I'm going off track here, but I'll go right back. They would go, man, get out of here with that hippity hoppity. And it was really based on a dance move. Mm-hmm. It was this move we would do when we would hop.
Uh-huh.
You know what I'm saying? And so they would go, man, y'all can't come in here with that hippity hoppity stuff. And
hippity hoppity shit, they would
say. Yeah, they would say hippity hoppity shit or hippity. They call us floor sweepers. And we used to wear the winter hats with the ball on it.
Uh-huh.
And when we do our move, we used to go to side to side. So they would call us boing yoings.
Uh-huh.
Like, get that, you know, boing yoing, boing yoing. Yeah, so, and so what made it popular was two people who popularized it.
Uh-huh.
And made it more fashionable. One was Lovebug Starsky,
uh-huh,
who was at Hollywood's parties.
Yep. DJ Hollywood.
DJ Hollywood.
Okay.
Who was emceeing, mm-hmm, the style that we MC now more than what we were doing in hip hop. Most people don't know that.
Mm-hmm.
That style originated as far as in our time in the disco scene.
Mm-hmm.
We were doing more toasting, Rudy Ray Moore, Hustlers Convention. You know, it was a full moon in the middle of June in the summer of 59. Dolemite.
Mm-hmm.
That is Rudy Ray Moore. Last Poets. And Starsky, who was at the Hollywood Jams, also interacted with Cowboy.
Mm-hmm.
And so those two
you
guys.
You gotta say who Cowboy is.
Cowboy is a member. Cowboy is a member of Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five.
Mm-hmm.
And he's one of the people who popularized the term. And I know a lot of people say, oh, they coined the phrase. The phrase was going on way before MC, and, mm-hmm, and certain people didn't know that when they started giving credit to certain things. So one of the things I try to do is correct the history and, okay, put it in the right perspective. So Cowboy and Starsky, rest his soul, are the two people who popularized that term, and it became the term that we use around 92, 93. Before that, it didn't have a name. And for us in the Bronx, we just called it B-beat music. Gotcha. And that depended on where you lived.
Mm-hmm.
You know, some people never heard that in the Bronx.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
You mean 82? We start the term hip-hop.
Yeah, we didn't call. When I first heard that term, I was like, huh? What's that?
But by 92, it was already being called. You mean 82 it got popular?
No, 92 is when the term hip, around the 90s is when.
Ah, 80s. We were saying hip-hop in the 80s, too.
Not in my neighborhood.
Okay.
But we didn't go to school either.
Yep, so. Okay. Go ahead.
So.
Go ahead, HB.
But, no, because I was just wondering, when did Shan say hip-hop?
Started off the quick. Yeah, that was the 80s.
Do it out in the dark. That was in the
80s. That was in the 80s.
Check the date on the release date of that record. Because that's what I do.
What year is it?
No,
1987.
Late 80s. Commercially, it was not called that commercially. That's what, okay, I'm saying. We may have used the phrase, but it was not commercially named hip-hop.
Okay.
It was not until like 92.
Okay, so where was Herc at? Herc
was on the west side. And, okay, and there's a lot of misnomers, and one of the things I'm trying to do is correct the history.
Okay.
One of the key things that created one of the problems is the Source cover magazine of the three, Herc, Bam, and Flash.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And they were referred to as the forefathers.
Yes.
That's incorrect.
Cool Herc, DJ Cool Herc, Africa Bambaataa.
And Flash.
Okay.
Grandmaster Flash. And Herc sits alone by himself.
Okay.
He is dominating all the parties. His collection of records is what we all gravitated to because he played for the B-boys. He played for the dancers. Everyone followed that. There were DJs before Kool Herc. Grandmaster Flowers,
uh-huh,
in 1968,
uh-huh,
he opened for James Brown in Yankee Stadium.
Okay.
A DJ. None of us will ever do that. You know what I'm saying?
Grandmaster Flowers.
Opened, okay, for James Brown. Now, okay, he played, you know, the commercially popular records.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
He didn't play obscure beats. You know what I'm saying? And so that's what made Kool Herc special.
Mm-hmm.
He played records that nobody played. Imagine going to a party and you hear all hit records that you don't hear on the radio. You know, and then he had a system that was similar to the guys in Queens and Brooklyn, because we didn't have systems like that.
Uh-huh.
And for the B-boys, we were satisfied with just dancing in the hallway with our box, right. Little radio. And we started making record button tapes, not pause button tapes, record button tapes. And that was the catalyst to cutting records because we wanted to extend the beat. And so we took the record button and the tab underneath, and we would manipulate that so that we can keep catching the record and editing it together. Finally, they came out with a pause button and made it a lot easier for us to do that. But that's where the whole thing of cutting originated from, the pause button, the cassette, the record button, then pause button. And then for any DJ who was a musician, like Imperial JC, Jazzy J, Rockin' Rob, and myself, we're all drummers. And so I never thought to cut off beat. And so the earlier DJs, they weren't on time. They were basically, it was a train wreck when they were cut.
Yeah.
And so, you know, the next generation came in. Flash was cutting on beat. Like when I first saw Flash, he was cutting on beat. Uh-huh. And I was like, okay, he cuts on beat.
Okay, so what generation with Flash, we consider the younger generation, right? Same generation?
See, the whole thing is, a lot of people think there's this vast amount of time that went by. No.
Nah, it was all...
Kool Herc is 73, 74, 75, and everybody else starts coming in around 75,
okay.
76. Disco King Mario is before Bambaataa, from that neighborhood. You don't hear his name because of the terminology. Because we used the term hip-hop, back then we used the term disco. And now that you don't use disco, the people who were doing hip hop with disco in their name are never mentioned. The Brothers Disco, which is the Funky Four, you don't hear about them.
They was
one of the most dominant hip hop groups ever, but their name was the Brothers Disco. And so because we got hooked on this word hip hop, it eliminated certain people out of the historical line. Lineage.
Put that in time perspective, Brothers Disco.
Brothers Disco is when we all started, 75, 76, the Brothers Disco. MCing with the MC groups doesn't happen until 78, late 78. That's when the groups started forming. There were no...
Like Cold Crush. And
Cold Crush is the 80s.
The 80s, okay.
Cold Crush happens in the 80s. The Furious Four.
Oh, okay.
Actually, originally it was the three MCs, Cowboy, Mel, and his brother Creo. And they became the Furious Four. The Brothers Disco had the Funky Four, which was KK Rockwell, Keith Caesar, Raheem, and Sha Rock. My group was the Infinity Four, and all these groups started at the same time. Basically, especially the Funky Four, because Raheem, I was trying to recruit him for me, for my group, because all of the MC groups basically went to the same school. So you're in your high school, and you get with guys that's rhyming in the hallway, and that's how most of the groups formed, based on what schools you went to.
And this, see,
And that's like when you think of Pro Era, you think of Wu-Tang Clan, and you think of all these, it's the same way those groups formed, right? Keep going, man. So why did this happen? You know, because I try to, you know, put it in context for a lot of the younger generation that, you know, it's different. People are motivated differently in 2019 why they make music and why they get into this than what was happening back then. Why was this important to happen? Well, and this is water, by the way, DXC.
Oh, yeah, thank you.
Yeah, go ahead.
You sure?
I mean, come on, man. I want to be in the history books for that. Sway gave him some water. And, hey, man,
if we had some other people in here, we'd have to use truth serum. So, you
okay.
know.
All right. But why did hip-hop happen? Why was it necessary? Who did it represent and...
It was a.
In your opinion. Yeah.
Well, here's the thing. What I try to do is answer questions like that and solve a problem at the same time.
Okay.
Okay. The term hip hop is what skews everything.
Okay.
Because we're listening to soul music.
Yes.
It's soul music. It's we're soul playing music. Our mother and father's record collection.
Okay.
James Brown was in my mother's collection.
Mm-hmm.
Bongo Rock, we saw that in a movie called The Thing with Two Heads, Ray Milland and Rosie Greer.
Mm-hmm.
And we're sitting in the theater and we hear this record, Bongo Rock. It was called, on the album, it's called Bongo Rock 72. That's when the movie came out. We saw that at the Melba Theater on Boston Road. The next year, it came out as a 45 called Bongo Rock 73. I guess they wanted to put it out. Mm-hmm. And that's when a lot of people started tuning into break parts in songs, like mm-hmm. really focusing on that. I think Bongo Rock was the key record. We had Keep On Doing It and all of the Crazy Legs and all these records before that. But Bongo Rock was the one that really set it for the dancers. And as far as the B-boy thing, it was B-girls and B-boys. When it started getting aggressive is when women started to fall back. And originally, females was doing the burning.
Uh-huh. Like if you gotta explain the term burning.
Burning is like you do a move and you give somebody the hand. The hand is from the 60s. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? You give somebody the hand, just like needle dropping. You know, we people are, you know, like my brother Theodore. That's my brother and I love him.
Mm-hmm. And Grand Wizard Theodore.
Yeah, Grand Wizard Theodore. He mm-hmm. says he invented needle dropping. Mm-hmm. But that was happening in the 60s. Mm-hmm. That was what you did at house parties. And the natural progression of the technology would automatically, you would automatically think, I want to play this part over. Mm-hmm. And so he didn't experience that.
Yeah.
And so he didn't know that. And so that's one of the things I'm trying to help people understand. You're not everywhere. And your eureka moment is your eureka moment. But then you have to do research to see what else is out there. You see what I'm saying? And so my sister, who's now in her 60s, she used to take the needle and try to get it back to the beginning of that part, the get down part, uh-huh. at the house party, because that's when they were burning each other. Finally, somebody went down, hit their knees, jumped up, and gave somebody a hand. Oh, you burnt. Get out the circle. You mm-hmm. know what I mean? And then it became more aggressive. But the two main cats in the Bronx that really set that off is Sasa and Trixie. And they were part of Kool Herc's crew as far as the really going down to the ground. But again, to your question, how did this all happen? It was by necessity.
Mm-hmm. Speak on that.
You know, you are in an environment where there's not much of anything, uh-huh. but your natural ability is to express yourself. Right. And as melanated people, our expression is a physical expression. Uh-huh. And so without being educated on the tribal thing and uh-huh. the rhythmic thing, it's just genetically in our natural being.
Yeah.
So when we hear these rhythms, mm-hmm. they speak to us in a way that we don't truly understand to this day because of the trauma. But it's enough to trigger a response to those rhythms and those frequencies.
Yeah.
And here we are.
Here we are. When did it, like, who was the first MC to kind of politicize the culture, in a sense, to really speak out on the conditions, the environment, the struggle?
I sense my telekinesis, everybody's saying the message.
No, I'm not.
No, not you.
Yeah. No,
somebody over there.
Somebody said the message. No, I'm
somebody
not.
Somebody over there. Somebody over there was going with the message.
The message, yeah, with Melly Mel, but.
The Last Poets.
The Last Poets.
E pluribus unum means one out of many.
Mm-hmm.
Selfish desires are burning like fires among those who hoard the gold mm-hmm. as they continue to keep the people asleep and the truth from being told.
Mm.
He's spitting.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Pygmy Markin was spitting. He was joking, but yeah, I think the Last Poets are in our time.
Yeah,
because we now know that people were rhyming from day one. We got people. The gospel choirs were rhyming exactly the way we rhyme in the 1930s.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly the same way.
Right.
Pygmy Markin, who lived in the Bronx, and the style that he uses is the style that we use today.
Mm-hmm.
And I think he passed away in the late 90s, so he actually heard us, and he did Here Comes the Judge.
Everybody,
I actually have a remix that I did of Pygmy Markin. I have it here with me today. Mm-hmm. And just to show people that here's a dude that was rhyming just like us. That recording is 1968.
Yeah, this court is now in session. His Honor, Judge Pygmeat Markin Poseidon.
He's spitting.
Yeah, he, the cool of swing. It's just about ready to do my thing. I don't want no tears, I don't want no lies. Above all, I don't want no alibis. This judge is hip, and that ain't all. He'll give you time if you're big or small. Fall in line, or this coat is neat.
Peace, brother.
Love. Here comes the judge.
Here comes the judge.
Everybody know that he is.
That's 1968?
That... My mother had that album. It was around 68, 60.
My mother had that.
My grandmother used to play that when it was frying chicken.
Yeah.
Right. So our parents was playing rap.
After picking cotton, Rich?
No. We from the Caribbean. We didn't pick cotton.
Oh, you damn lie.
Sugar cane. We had sugar cane.
Okay.
Sugar
okay.
Cane. Sugar cane.
And boogers. Now. You walked into that.
You know what? I'm going to take some calls, man. If you're just interested in this, this is really great. Grand Mixer DXT is here. Brave from Florida is on the line. 888-742-3345. Brave, what up?
Hey.
What's going on, Sway? What's up, family? Heather B, Tracy B.
Hi.
Or Tracy G, rather. W-E-O-Q.
All right.
What's up, family?
What's happening?
Chilling, man. Listen, I got a question for the bruh. I'm a truck driver,
man. Hold on. Stop.
Yeah, I don't wear bras.
Yeah, call. This his name is. Listen. Hold up. This is one of our pioneers. His name is Grand Mixer DXT.
All right.
You got to call.
So
you
got to. I said corrected because that has to do with my question. So Grand Mixer DXT. I'm humble.
Yes.
I stand corrected and I'm humbled of the elder because I know you
that's
are
love.
Definitely a pioneer, just like the brothers say. So I stand corrected.
Okay, that's love. Go ahead. So what's your question?
Right, yes. So listen, I always wonder whatever happened to the terms grandmaster. And he's like you grandmaster. Why those terms ever go away? Because there's DJs out there I know that still deserve that title. I always thought that title was dope, grandmaster. Because it's like a kung fu when you're dealing with the abbot. It's like you at the pinnacle. So like DJs like Jazzy Jeff or like Primo. I don't understand why we don't still give those great DJs that homage, that title of a grandmaster or even grandmixer.
Why did it go away?
Why did it went away?
Well, it didn't go away. See, in the Bronx, it was about being unique.
Mm-hmm.
There was no biting.
Biting means copying another individual and stealing their style.
Yeah, chewing on somebody's food.
Yeah.
And so we tried to be as original as possible. I was inspired by Flash to create a name like that because he was Grandmaster. And Grand Wizard Theodore was Grand Wizard. And Imperial JC was Imperial JC. And Jazzy J was the original Jazzy J. And so I honed in on a certain skill set, and that was the mixer. My ability to manipulate the mixer was different from the other brothers. Mm-hmm. And so the grand is what is the active word in it, the grand.
Mm-hmm.
So I wanted to be the grand mixer.
Mm-hmm.
You know, people still say, you're the grand mixer, you're a grandmaster, but we know you're the grand mixer, but you're still a grandmaster to us. And I take that, even when you said that, I acknowledge it.
Well, I just stumbled on it. I said it by mistake when I said grand wizard. I meant grand mixer. but it, you know, and I understood the mistake. And I look
at it more as me being the Black Klansman.
Okay. All right, it's nice.
Let's talk about some of the records for a second, because I think that people kind of lose the context of how these beats were found, who found these beats, how these beats spread it through the Bronx and through the world. And let's talk about that a little bit.
Okay, well, the collection I played, that's from Kool Herc's crates. We call that the Sacred Crates. It's the very first collection of records that we was hearing at his jams. And then once the rest of us picked up the whole idea of obscure records, certain people started to get seriously involved in that. And I met a gentleman by the name of, we called him Kool-Aid. And,
Kool-Aid, that's
right. And he's one of the unsung heroes of the culture because a high percentage of the records that we were playing, he was the one who discovered them.
Kool-Aid. Okay.
From the Bronx.
He joined my crew, and so that put me in a good position because I started playing records that no one else played. And here's the whole thing about back then. Your crowd and your ability to draw people was based on the obscurity of your records.
Mm-hmm.
Where people, Herc used to say this term, you never heard it like this before. And he was dead serious mm-hmm. about that. Because when he played Apache, I'm speechless now.
Mm-hmm.
Like no one, and it was on the Bongo Rock album. But we all had the 45.
Right.
He had the album.
So.
And he played Apache, and everybody was like, huh? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Breakout played Last Night Changed It All. First time. And,
Last
and
night.
So all of us, every DJ would hear those records, and then we'd have to go find them.
Uh-huh.
Because at your party, if you don't have that record, you're not up.
You're going to lose.
You're going to lose.
So that's why people would black out the records so you couldn't see.
You the labels of the record.
Well, Herc started doing that because we got that from Herc. Most of the things we got from Herc.
So people would black out the label on the record so you couldn't see what he was playing.
You couldn't see what it was.
Yeah.
Kool-Aid knew music. He knew records. He knew songs. He knew who was singing. He knew the drummer. He knew. And so he would go and find these records, and then obscure records.
Uh-huh.
There was a young brother who worked in the downstairs records. His name was Elroy. And we used to go there and discuss records with him to find for us so that we would stay up on everybody else. Bam was also very good with his record
Africa
collection.
Bambaataa.
Yeah, they referred to him as the master of records. And in some ways he was, but as far as beats, there was a lot of other cats. And Kool-Aid was like one of the main cats.
DJ Kool-Aid.
Kool-Aid.
Okay.
And along with Bambaataa, Africa Islam was also one of the guys who was really good and savvy with finding beats. The most of the and Herc's collection.
Uh-huh.
And most of the records that everyone plays came from out of that small group of people. And the whole thing was, it was an unwritten law that in your crew, you do not give away the name of the records. And every weekend, you go out and search for more beats.
So let me ask you this, because the common thread in this is originality, being an innovator,
right.
Being unique, not biting, was a principal law in our culture, right?
Right.
Nowadays, it's the total opposite. Now, people follow what other people have done to become successful and do it like them. And that might be, I don't know, I see you back in there. You ready?
I was about to say, in that's a long Otello. I don't know if you want to dive into that, because it goes way deeper than just finding records. It's a social issue. It's not just the idea of people like trying to copy somebody. I mean, that goes much deeper into the subconsciousness of our community, because the truth is, hip hop is a virus for us now.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
It's poison. It puts more of us in the hospital, in the cemetery. You see what I'm saying? In prison. And it's no longer an immunity. It's no longer an immune system for our people. That's what a culture is supposed to do. It's supposed to be an immunity system for your people. And when your immune system is not acting right, you discard what's ailing it. And we have chosen to embrace the ailments of our community. We promote drugs and sex and everything that would destroy a people. We promote it openly, and no one has anything to say about it. So we have succumbed to the ills of the social system that we've been conditioned into. And so to use hip hop and parade it as if it's actually something good suggests that there is a systemic mental issue going on with our people.
Hmm. Could the same?
Yeah, you can cut that check now.
You know what? I'm gonna end it right there. How about that? Leave him with something to think about. I love you. Thank you, Grand Mixer DXT.
Love you, D.
Coming through, man.
Appreciate you.
Come on, man.
Bronx is in the house.
Yes,
gotta
indeed.
Take HB. BX, stand
what
up.
What do you have coming up?
I'm promoting Team Hip Hop, and Team Hip Hop is our battle cry. Is a culture with no moral responsibility to its youth is no culture at all. Mm. Fortunately, some superheroes are real. I'm the first turntablist on the planet. I got a cape,
so I
have a responsibility to the young people. Our ground zero is Chicago, because they've killed more brothers and sisters than the Iraqi war. And there's not one person really talking about that. And we talk about everything else other than what ails our community. And we praise hip hop, but we don't look at what it's doing to our community. It is not doing good. There are no artists right now that is standing up. And I challenge anyone to challenge me on that. that is really going hard to correct and help organize the community or the culture, if we want to call it that, to correct this problem. People are dying and being murdered and getting sick through what we think is a culture, and it is not functioning like a culture. Your culture is your immune system within the social system that you are in.
Grand Mixer DXT, I got to introduce you to folks like, I got to introduce you to some of those artists that I know that are out there.
I like Oprah Winfrey's album. I think that's dope.
Well, nah, there's some artists out there. Like David Banner is somebody who marches a lot.
I love David Banner.
Common.
Common, somebody. Killer Mike. It's some T.I. There's some folks out there.
Kendrick, like I said, Chicago, so those guys in Chicago, Common and these guys, those are the guys I need to get with because we're going there.
Yeah.
What Team Hip Hop does is we do master classes. Right, I'm doing a master class in February 23rd, and I'm showing how I did scoring for the Dr. Dre, Jimmy Iovine thing on HBO.
The Defiant Ones.
The Defiant Ones. I'm showing how I did that, but the conversation, I always steer it into social issues with the young people.
Absolutely.
And I use that to get in, you know what I'm saying? And so we teach mind, body, soul, culture, nutrition, agriculture. Agriculture is going to be the most profitable business on the planet. It's going to be worth more than anything, and if you don't know that, look into it. Agriculture is going to be worth more than anything. Food is going to become the most valuable item on the planet. Food.
Grand Mixer DXT, how can people find out about the organization if they want to join, if they want to contribute? How can they reach out to you?
Here's one of the things. We do a tour the Bronx every year. I mentioned that to you and Rich Nice, and I didn't get no calls back. But
damn, I could have sworn he was on the show today. Yo, man, he never lighten up on us, man.
I'm at the point now where I keep it 1 trillion
Brilliant,
now.
Yeah.
There's no time. There's no time, man. You know what I'm saying? I'm here because I love y'all.
Uh-huh.
And this is a platform that is a very important platform. It is the best platform for our people. Your show is the best since Video Music Box.
Wow. Thank you.
Check that out.
Thank you.
Uncle Ralph and then you. That's it. And so we have very few avenues, and I'm not dissing nobody. This is what I feel.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? And so it is critical that we do what we are supposed to do as men. As men. I saw a video today of a dude being murdered on the train station platform, and people are videotaping it.
Crazy.
Yeah. Yeah.
I seen a girl get knocked out, and dudes is videotaping it by a dude. And dudes is videotaping it. There's no men. Where's the men? And what's going on in Chicago? What's going on in Chicago? You know what I'm saying? We're in trouble.
People want to reach out to you. They can. How?
Grand Mixer DXT on all social media platforms.
Okay. Man, I appreciate you, man. This really...
I'm putting you and Rich on the spot. Are y'all riding next in October?
Yeah.
You ready?
Y'all heard that?
You ride it?
Yeah. Yeah,
Team Hip Hop, you got to get your jersey.
What does riding mean exactly? What are we doing?
On a bike.
Oh, shit, nah.
See?
That's
See?
Right, because you go like 40 miles. How many?
You can do 20. It's 25 and 40 on that. 25 miles, 40 miles.
I was like 40 miles, D. Come on, man.
Hey, listen, man.
Come on, you have a Peloton bike. This should be easy.
You needed to sneak and tell her that one day.
I really wanted to say, can he just do it from his house?
I could put 40 on my Peloton. Hey, what if Tracy G joins us too?
You want to join?
I love biking. Anything with movement,
okay.
I'm down.
Okay.
Okay. What about Heather?
I'm good.
You good?
Give this brother your card.
Okay. I ain't riding.
Can you get Heather to do it, D?
Sure.
I'll set up a food stand on the end at the end of the ride.
We need team members, and they all don't have to be riders.
But
master classes is an absolute. You got to give a master class. You got to teach the children. You got to get to the kids.
I teach them how to cook.
That's and that's part of agriculture. That's right. So there you go.
Use my purpose.
All right. Hey, follow him at Grand Grand Mixer MixerDXT.
Can I give some shout outs?
Sure.
Oh, big shout out to Rhonda Supreme because she actually made this all happen with Rich Nice and Sway.
Rich.
Shout out to Angela Williams holding it down in the house. My children, they remain anonymous. Mom, love you, Mom.
Herbie, you want to shout out Herbie?
Oh, of course. I'm going to see Herbie in a few days.
Can you get Herbie to come up here?
I think so.
I respect that, too. I get that.
I think so. I think I can make that
We
happen.
Could have a really warm, historical conversation with him.
Yeah, I think I could do that.
Thank you, brother. You're all right with me. I'll see you in October.
All right.
You promise, bro?
I promise, because what you just said makes sense. If I don't ride, I'll do something else, but I'll be there.
Okay.
All right?
Y'all heard that.
I promise, and we'll promote it.
And Rich Nice.
I'll be there.
You riding, Rich?
You know what? In October, I should be clear. I should be clear for physical activity.
Official members of Team Hip Hop.
Okay.
And you get your cape, too.
I get to wear my cape.
Get your cape. Did you see it? You saw them?
I've seen the capes. Yeah.
You saw them?
Yeah. Do I gotta wear the uniform?
Did y'all can y'all post it up?
I post the uniform.
We'll post it. All right.
You saw it.
Yeah. It's dope.
Thank you very kindly for your presence, man. I appreciate it.
Hey, thank y'all for having me. Absolutely. Really appreciate it. I really appreciate the opportunity to express my feelings.
Okay, absolutely. Thank you. Grand Mixer DXT. Up next, man, we got the one and only Maury Povich is here. You want to talk to Maury? Maybe somebody's accusing you of fathering their child? 888-742-3345.
Oh, I need to stay for that.
You got to stay for that.